Jewish Education and Media is pleased to present L'Chaim, a program that highlights the people, issues, and events of importance to the Jewish community. Now here is your host, Rabbi Mark Golub.
I'm Mark Golub, and on this edition of L'Chaim, I want you to meet a remarkable human being, a husband, an extraordinary father, as you're about to hear. A rabbi, though that may be the least relevant for why I want you to meet him. He's a human being who has lived through and transcended a very difficult and painful life experience involving one of his children. And I know that many of you who watch Shalom TV, you are parents yourselves. And you know nothing tears at a human soul more than a child in pain. It's a privilege for me to welcome to L'Chaim Charles Sherman, Chuck Sherman, who's written his family's story centered on this truly remarkable son, Eyal, and the book is entitled The Broken and the Whole, Discovering Joy After Heartbreak, published by Scribner. Chuck Sherman is also the rabbi of Temple Adath Yeshurun in Syracuse, New York, a conservative synagogue he has served for, close to 40 years? Close to 40 years. With the most distinguished list of accomplishments as an outstanding member of the conservative rabbinate. And Chuck Sherman is what is known as a rabbi's rabbi. And Chuck, thank you so much for joining me on L'Chaim.
You know, I appreciate the invitation.
I told you off camera, The Broken and the Whole. You know, people go on television, they've written a book, and it's appropriate, no matter who you sit with, the host should say something nice about the book. Yeah. And I've struggled with how I want to tell you what this book, I can't read a page of this book without crying. And it's crying because it's insightful, it's touching, it is not arrogant, and it's hard to write this book and not be arrogant. It doesn't aggrandize. It is a love poem to your wife, Leah. Just fabulous. So we should begin at the beginning. The story is about Eyal. You have five children.
Right. Eyal is the is our oldest son. He was number three in the pecking order.
Okay. And he's born, he grows, he's 3 years old, he's 4 years. He seems like an ordinary, happy kid.
Yeah, he looks like a big kid. A gorgeous-looking kid. He looked like Buster Brown with a rotund face and bangs. I tell people, I thought he was going to play middle linebacker for the New York Giants.
Oh, really?
Which doesn't say much for Eyal during when he was born. But a physical kid, loved sports, and like most kids, you know, had usual kinds of respiratory conditions, ear infections, and
Nothing out of the ordinary, really?
Nothing that would alarm us,
okay,
and say there's
something. Then what happens?
What happens is that some of the ear infections become more pronounced and more frequent, and there's that moment, I remember the night, it was in March of 1986, when in the middle of the night, I discover him really in the bedroom, and he's got a high temperature. He can't focus, his legs are jiggling, and call a doctor and says, you know, wait until the morning. We take him in the morning to a pediatrician. And within 48 hours, we go from a pediatrician to a ER to a pediatric surgeon, admission to the hospital, onto a pediatric floor, into a PICU, pediatric intensive care unit. And we're told that he has a lesion not on his brainstem, but in his brainstem.
In his brainstem,
about the size of a golf ball. And the brainstem, I know nothing about medicine. I've since learned, controls respirations and heart rate. And we are told the irony, the language that the medical community uses, they said he's got maybe at most a couple of weeks to live. Take him home and enjoy the time.
You're told this.
Oh, absolutely.
You and Leah are told this by a doctor?
Yeah, and we are expecting our fifth child in about 4 months when this whole thing happens.
Okay. You said, by the way, it's 48 hours from the time you take him to the hospital. Which hospital do you go to?
We go to upstate in Syracuse.
Okay. So, Chuck, a doctor says to you, your kid has a couple of months to live. What goes through your head?
It's like somebody takes a baseball bat. You know, when I think a lot of people have that experience, hit you in the chest, and you can't swallow, the food doesn't go down, and this is before the internet. And, you know, I think like a lot of parents, I don't think it's just me, if your child faces a serious challenge, you're going to look, the word impossible doesn't part of your vocabulary, and you start searching from friends and reading books and going to the library and resources.
But that's not in the first 48 hours. I'm asking you, take me to that moment, and what do you and Leah say to each other?
We're scared. We are frightened. We don't know what to do.
Do you believe it? Do you remember maybe you don't remember.
Yeah,
I'm asking you, I'm for a parent to hear your child has 4 months to live, it's almost impossible for a parent to assimilate that information. But I was wondering, when you heard this, did you believe it? Or did you say, no, this cannot be?
I believed it, but did not accept it. Okay, believed it, but not accepted it. And as a result, what we had to do was quickly change our mindset and to say, okay, fine, this is what they told us. There's got to be somebody else out there.
So you started looking for another doctor?
You bet we did.
Of
looking
course.
For a doctor, for someone who will give us really another option.
And whom did you find?
We found a physician in New York City at NYU, a mentor of a person. It was Dr. Fred Epstein.
And what was his specialty?
Pediatric neurosurgery. He was one of the few people, though the only person, who was going after lesions in the brainstem. And what he said to us is, bring him down. I don't know what I can do. That's all we needed to hear, is someone to open up the door just a little. And we arranged to fly him down to New York City, which is a terrific story.
Also, is he conscious here?
He is conscious. He is on a trach, not yet a ventilator. It's difficult for him to walk, very, very fragile. He looked like the Pillsbury Doughboy because they had blown up with steroids in order to reduce the swelling of the brainstem.
Did he have any sense of what was happening to him? He's 4 years old here.
He was aware. And I think what's made this journey a little easier is that he has never, ever, ever expressed a sense of self-pity, a sense, really, a fear. He's a very trusting, young kind of guy.
How remarkable.
It really is. And I think it's part of the story that's not told about his personality. If he wasn't, it would have created even more angst and maybe guilt and anguish, really, and frustration for us. But he was very, very accepting. It wasn't, you know, I don't want to live, I don't want to go through this. Never found that kind of response, really, from Eyal.
Is he an affectionate person?
Oh, yeah, very, very much so. Very, very, very much so.
Is your wife affectionate?
Absolutely.
Are you affectionate?
You probably have to ask other people that, okay?
Are you a hugger or not necessarily?
Yeah, listen, I'm a pulpit rabbi.
I'm asking because I'm trying to imagine, is there an attempt, it's your four-year-old son, Is there a sense of wanting to just cradle him, hold him, or is it that you're at the moment in such fatherly panic that's not what goes on?
There really wasn't fatherly panic. What it was is that, and maybe because in terms of being, this happened when I was 40, 41 years of age, I had some life experience under my belt, but I realized is that it would be counterproductive mm-hmm. to engage in those kinds of emotions. Yeah, there were moments that I cried terribly when I was alone, driving the car, taking a shower in the morning, shaving, looking in the mirror. But what I needed to do, use whatever energies I had and resources to be as constructive and positive as possible. And therefore, what I use most of my energies in order for that search. What we've been able to do, see, most marriages don't survive the kind of challenges that we've had. And what we do is that, I don't know if it's consciously or subconsciously, we divide it really in terms of what we would do. My wife does the day-to-day kind of stuff. She really is the hero in the story. She really does the hands-on kinds of things really with Eyal. What I do, I deal really with the bigger picture. I deal in terms of finding physicians. I deal in terms of arguing with insurance companies, entitlements, making sure that he gets the quality of care, making sure that if something comes onto the scene, and it always does, is that we become aware of it, make that phone call, say, can we engage that person? So that happened almost immediately. Almost immediately. So some of the questions that you asked, you know, are not part of really of our life experience. We quickly shifted into a mode. Okay, fine, this is where we are. Now, what are we going to do about it? We focused like a laser.
Wonderful. So you end up in New York?
At NYU.
At NYU. And what happens then?
And what happens then is that the surgery is successful. We are jubilant. It is, they've removed most of the lesion. And then 3 days later, we recognize the risk. He had a brainstem stroke, and he fell into...
This is post-surgery.
Yeah, and fell into a vegetative coma for days, weeks, and months, and months, and months. I mean, totally, totally out of it.
Were you destroyed at that point?
Yeah. Yeah, destroyed. Yeah, I mean, absolutely. You know, living in that zone of uncertainty. We don't know really what was going to happen, and I had responsibilities and obligations, you know, as a father, and as a son, and in terms of in the synagogue, my wife and myself picked ourselves up and we moved to New York City. We just had the baby was born in the middle of all this. Our parents, my parents living what I like to tell people, that the capital Jewish city in America, which of course is Boca, at their age they came up to take care of our children, and we made the statement we would never, ever, ever leave him alone, day and
Eyal, you would never leave Eyal alone.
Never, both of us either slept at his bedside, either my wife or myself. We would engage him. We would have conversations with him, even though in this vegetative coma, is that there was a human person there, and there was life there, and he was terribly compromised. But you know, to use a Jewish concept, there was Demut Elohim. There was the image of God there, and it taught me as a lesson, by the way, as a pastor, in terms of my own life experience from that day on, how to deal with people in some really, really tough situations. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So we never left him alone
and
engaged him.
Yes.
And treated him as he was one of the other kids. And periodically, we would bring the other kids down to New York City. And it's frightening. These are the days, if you remember, what ICUs look like. There was one big room with a curtain, and the kids would play with him. We'd show him pictures, somehow to reawaken his soul and his spirit. And it went on for months and months and months.
Is he on a ventilator yet?
Yeah, he was put on a vent post-op, and he nothing moved. Nothing moved. And
you're waiting day after day after day.
Correct. Waiting, waiting, and waiting.
And hoping.
And praying.
What does that mean?
It means is that as Havoc, you know, prayer is reflective.
Mm-hmm.
So it's have a conversation with God, but it's also having a conversation with myself. That there's one thing that I remember. I remember being at NYU one night, 2 o'clock in the morning. It's a small unit, an open unit. And I take a look, and I see a kid across from where I'm sitting, from the Dominican Republic. And the kid has a very bad blood disease. And his grandmother is holding the rosary. She's got her head really in the metal bars, and she's praying. Behind me is a kid they brought in from Cairo. It's an international kind of hospital, and the youngster had some serious reconstructive facial surgery, and the father was reading the Quran. Over in the other corner, there was a kid who came in from Utah, someplace there. They were Jehovah's Witnesses. Kid hydrocephalus, water on the brain, little baby, 19 months old. And the reason they used that hospital was the neurosurgeon agreed not to use any blood transfusions. Right across from me is a kid relief in Bedford-Stuyvesant, 14 years of age, young girl. And her name was Squeaky, and she was going to have a heart transplant the next day. And I remember why they called her Squeaky, because she kept screaming, "Jesus, you're not ready for me yet. Jesus, you're not ready for me." And I was sitting bedside with Eyal, and I was reading for the book of Tehillim, the book of Psalms. I've had lots of religious experiences in my life. I thought that room was going to levitate.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I thought, you know, so when you talk about prayer, it was like, even though everybody had their own faith tradition there, the spiritual energy in that room was really special. And I've seen it in other places as well. It's what I call the community of those who are hurting. You become friends with people who you never ever thought an economic station, culturally, educationally, that you'd ever be friends with. But illness and challenges like that create a common denominator. That's what it does.
In essence, you also took time away from your congregation.
Yes. It's I got my priorities right.
Good for you. So you're waiting and you're waiting and you're hoping and you're praying, and then what happens?
And what happens is that, a great story. I'm watching the Boston Red Sox playing the New York Mets in 1986.
The World Series.
You bet. And what happens is that Eyal liked baseball. As a kid, I used to watch baseball games with him. And he liked the third baseman for the Mets, Howard Johnson. Because he had a kid in nursery school, good friend Howard Johnson. And watching the game with him, my wife is relaxing in the parents' room, lying down for a little while.
Well, it's an interesting statement. What do you mean you're watching the game with him?
Well,
isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
What you mean is you're watching the game next to him.
That's.
But you felt you were with him, didn't you?
Yeah, I like that. Yeah,
you felt you were with
absolutely.
Him.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
That's marvelous.
So I'm watching the game with him. And they announce Howard Johnson. And Howard Johnson comes to bat. Now, again, Eyal had a friend by the Howard. And all of a sudden, his eyes open, and he opens his mouth and goes, "I thought I was nuts, okay?" And I run over to the resident, and I said, I think something's happening here. And they said, "No, it's an illusion." A couple innings later, the center fielder for the Mets, by the name of Mookie Wilson, he loved Mookie Wilson because he liked the name, and he comes to bat. And they see Mookie Wilson, his eyes open again, and he says, and he came out of his vegetative coma by watching the Mets play the Red Sox in the 1986 World Series. And that's how it happened. But when he came out of it, his body was broken. He was a total quadriplegic.
Don't jump ahead.
Yeah.
You're at your son's bedside. He's mouthing Howard Johnson, Mookie Wilson. And all of a sudden, he is watching that game with you.
Yes.
And you felt what? How did you, your body stay inside your body at that point?
First thing, I ran as fast as I could down to the parents' room to get my wife and to say, "You ain't going to believe this." And there was a sense really of hope restored, a sense of encouragement, and a real belief that this was the beginning of a long journey, but it was the beginning of a journey that was going to end really, really, really well.
Forgive me, did you understand then how hard the journey you were about to start was? Did you understand that then?
Yeah, I did.
You knew even if he regained consciousness, he was going to be, in your words, broken?
I didn't realize how broken. I thought at that particular time is that as he began to regain function, that it would sort of be like a Legos, you know, that going or dominoes falling down. We get this would come back, that would come back.
Dominoes
come
in back. A good sense, though.
Right, but I never, you know, again, you're probably correct. I didn't realize how arduous it was going to be, the challenges we'd face, and that I have to redefine what the end game was, what the promised land was.
From that, what to what, Chuck?
Initially, I wanted Eyal back the way he was before that night in March. As the years passed, I've recognized I have him back, but it's different. It's different. It's a different kind of normal. And that's all right. That's all right. Because in a certain way, universal messages, that's really what life really is all about. Yet I'm not the same person I was in March of 1986. I'm not the same person I was, 3 weeks ago. You know, you grow from these life experiences and challenges that you have. And I think all of us, our kids really as well. And what we've done is try to create a normal environment. You know, I tell people, see, most people try and take ordinary life experiences and make them extraordinary. What we do the flip side. We take extraordinary life experiences and make them ordinary. Ordinary is good.
You understand, by the way, in the context that you've said it, you do make them extraordinary. Ordinary for Eyal and for you in this context, and for Leah and for your other children, everything you've done is extraordinary. But I understand what you mean. I want you to explain to the audience, and now just in the sweep of it, Eyal's physical condition became quickly, you understood it, became what?
Basically, he was totally dependent upon other people.
Could he speak?
No, his vocal cords were frozen, and we call it the silent voice.
He cannot speak?
No. He cannot speak, he cannot eat, he cannot walk, he cannot use any of his limbs. He has very, very, very limited motion of his head. His eyes have limited vision because he has, because the brainstem doesn't function correctly. His eyelids don't close. Therefore, he gets dry eyes, has to be lubricated all the time. He has limited hearing as well. It's a body that truly, truly is broken. But what he can do is that cognitively, he's intact.
His mind is intact.
Absolutely. And so he's a graduate of Syracuse University. He's got a Bachelor of Fine Arts. He's a painter. Paints really with a mouth stick. He engages the world. He had a bar mitzvah. Reads Hebrew really, really well. Studies Parshat HaShavua, the weekly portion. My wife usually teaches him that. I sometimes engage in it as well. Does the New York Times crossword puzzle, which I can't do. And the way he does it, my wife will enlarge it into big, big, big letters and blocks. Says to him, Eyal, this is what the clue is. This is how many boxes there are. And I don't know how many people of your listeners are able to do New York Times crossword puzzle every day. But it keeps his mind engaged.
Your son is brilliant. That, by the way, is the gift he has. And what becomes clear is, you know, it's not about one person versus another person. We're not comparing. We're not comparing tragedies. We're not comparing illness. We're not comparing success stories. This, in and of itself, however, is a story about as wonderful as you are as a father, and Leah, an extraordinary mother. And, you know, again, you have one son here. You have
right.
You have four other beautiful children who have done extraordinary things within the Jewish world as well. Kol hakavod to you and your entire family. But the real story is here. This human being, who was four when he was struck, has a dominating spirit, will, and mind. And what I didn't know is, and I need you to talk to me about that for a moment, it's one thing to do the crossword puzzle. I want to know about his soul. What I mean by that is, and then you have to tell me how you know the answer to my question. Is this a sweet person? Is this an angry person? Is this a happy person? Is this a person with a sense of humor, or sense of humor doesn't apply? Describe the tone of your son.
I think he's everything that you said. You know, it's not a singular kind of personality. A human being is such that he has a sense of humor. He becomes angry, uses words that I think are inappropriate. Just like sometimes, to be quite honest, I may engage in that kind of salty kind of language. He's curious. He's loving.
How is he loving?
What he is
How can somebody who can't speak and can't move express loving?
He's able to do it without words. And this is one of the things, you know, I do words for a living. And what he's able to, it's through his body language. Again, you can look at somebody and see if they like you or not.
Yes.
You can see if somebody is happy. You can tell someone is, I know when he's angry, he doesn't say I'm upset. I could see it in his eyes. And what do they say? You know, through the eyes, you could see the soul.
Absolutely.
Really, of the person. I could see it, for example, when he smiles. What makes him happy?
Does he smile?
Absolutely.
Does he laugh even if there's no sound?
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, his brothers and sisters engage him. So what we did early on. We try to make the house as genuine and authentic as possible when he came home after a couple of years in institutions.
How long was it?
It was 2 years. He came home, and he came on Erev Rosh Hashanah, which is an interesting story because the day that he came home, I had to walk up the hill to shul, had to preach in front of a couple thousand people, and they knew the challenges really that we were facing. But what we did at home, we recognized we had to create an atmosphere of joy and celebration. What we did, you know, we do silly things. We used to put on Disney shows. I, of course, being the father, I was Prince Charming and Cinderella. My wife was the director. And Erez, Eyal's younger brother, and Eyal, we dressed them up really as the coachman with whiskers and things like that. But it created laughter, and we still look back on those kinds of days. And even in the hospital, even the kids picked up on that. What they would do is that they would take latex, the gloves they use in the hospital, they fill them up with water. They would do water shows for him. So it's taking mundane things and creating the sense of joy, really, for this youngster. And, you know, people sometimes come up to me and say, boy, your life must be terrible. It really isn't. Our life is terrific. I'd rather have learned the lesson in a book. But what I have is that I understand what's important in my life. There are very few things that drive me up a wall. Make it angry at something happens in the synagogue, disappointment or frustration. You know what? I come home at night, I see Eyal, I embrace him. Hug him, kiss him, watch a ball game with him. We go out all the time, really, with him to a mall. We try and find something to do every day to engage him, to recognize that he's part of the human race and the community.
This happens to him when he's 4 years old. As a person grows and matures, one becomes aware of life in a very different way. At some point, this happens to him. At some point, he has to understand, A, what happened to him physically, and B, how different his life is than either it could have been or how different it is from all the lives around him. How does he deal with that?
I think the way he's been able to deal with it, and I've had some, not issues, but confusion really with it. You see, we have protected him. Even though he's now 32, 33 years of age, in many ways he's a child. There's an innocence about him. It's like, for example, if a child loses a loved one in the family at a very young age, you bring the kid to the funeral. What do you tell the child? You know, in today's world, we think, you know, you've got to be brutally honest and candid and tell everybody what's happening. We've taken a different approach. We really have respected his innocence and his naivete. And so on one hand, even though he is an adult, in many ways he's a child.
Good for
with
you.
With that loving sense of freshness. So for example, is that we don't shove it in his face.
Mm-hmm.
We'll tell him, for example, if he needs a procedure or something needs to be done, but we don't really just overwhelm him with it, and we move along with life in that kind of way. So that's the way we've been dealing really with it, and I think he's picked up it on as well. You know, we don't sit down with him and say, Eyal, when you were 4 years of age. What we do say, Eyal, do you remember when we were 4 years of age and we went to Nanny and Pa's and he used to take all the M&Ms? Eyal, remember when we used to go to Atlantic City onto the boardwalk? So we let him know there was a time before. We have photographs of him before really he was sick. We have photographs, for example, when he was a child, just like any other child. But we don't really beat him over the head or ourselves of what we once had before. Because I tell people, if you go down that path, you're not going to survive. See, I have an interesting philosophy. I live in the moment. I don't look behind me. I don't look in front of me. I don't look aside. I don't look to the right. It's a horrible way to drive a car. I live in this moment, and the verse that's become really the verse for our family is Zeh Hayom Asa Adonai Nagila V'Nismechavo. This is the day that God has created. This is the day. Now, what day is it?
Finish the rest of it.
Yeah, Nagila V'Nismechavo.
Right.
And you shall rejoice in it. All we have is today. And that's our philosophy of life. And today is today's pretty good. Pretty good day.
Do you think he ever felt sorry for himself?
I'm sure there were moments.
He has a right to, you know.
Oh, absolutely. And we all do.
Yes,
we
do.
All do. I mean, that's part of the human personality.
Yes.
I'm sure there are moments when he, because his sleep patterns are strange, but I'm sure there are moments like all of us that he looks up in the ceiling and he questions life, all kinds of existential kinds of questions that we all have. But what we try and do is not become frozen with those kinds of conversations, because it'll suck the energy out of you. It'll just, it'll drag you down into this dark hole that you will never, ever, ever climb out of. My wife has the same personality, by the way, and maybe that's why it does work. She will not allow, and we also are.
She will not allow what? Finish the thought.
She will not allow dark thoughts to overwhelm her. She will not. You know, one of the strategies that we've been able to develop, and this is done not thoughtfully, it just happens, we surround ourselves with hopeful, optimistic people. We have nurses around the clock, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. Rarely does that happen. What happens frequently is there's a block of time, we don't have anyone. My wife is able to do that kind of thing. She's learned it for part of his care. But what happens is that if I had a dollar, for every person we've said, thank you for working with us, but you're not for us. I could retire from the rabbinate. And the reason being is because we want people who are hopeful and optimistic. Because you convey that optimism, not simply with words, but by touch. My mother, I said before, came up to visit from Florida frequently, and it was hard for her. You know, even though I was in my 40s and 50s when she was coming, even 60s, is that she'd walk into the room and she'd cry hysterically when she'd come into the house. And I said, Ma, I love you very, very much, and you're terrific. I just bought you a ticket back to Boca. And she said, why? I said, because in this house here, I can't tolerate that. Okay, it's not simply just for Eyal. It's for Leah and myself and the rest of the kids. What we need here are cheerleaders. We need advocates. We need doctors who believe that he will get better. And we surround ourselves with those kinds of people. We can think we're Pollyannish and we're silly, but optimism and hope is part of the prescription of the healthy lifestyle.
That's wonderful. Did your mother understand?
Yes, she did.
Did she ever adopt the attitude? Or was it just too hard for her?
She was able to understand as we went through life cycles that there were happy times. You look at the book of Ecclesiastes, and Ecclesiastes says, there's that famous chapter for everything, there's a season, but a time to laugh and a time to cry, a time to mourn, time to celebrate. And I used to believe that when I was in school. What I've since learned, Mr. Ecclesiastes got it wrong. It's not either or, it's both. And the challenge is learning to live your life with both the sadness and the happiness. You can be sad and happy at the same time. I told my daughter that right before her bat mitzvah, when she didn't want to have it because Eyal was so sick. And I reminded her when she got married and Eyal was wheeled down the aisle to be an usher at her wedding, you could be sad and you could be happy at the same time, that we don't live at the edges. Most of life is lived right smack in the middle, where it becomes confusing and it's difficult and it's sloppy and it's ambiguous, ambivalent, but that's what life really is. It's not that clean.
I want to take only a brief moment because there's only so much time I have with you, but I do want you to take a moment. How in the world does Eyal go to school and then go to a university?
What happened there is that we were convinced, perhaps when he came home, that he would not go to school. It would be impossible. Especially, we're from upstate New York. You know, in July, it snows 11 feet. We get 3 weeks of summer, and then it starts to snow again on Tisha B'Av. I mean, that's what it is. And schools at that particular point in New York State were very open and very inclusive. And they arranged for my wife to go to school, an aide, a nurse for a couple hours a day. He was 2 years behind grade level, but he loved education. And then we had a homebound school teacher for an hour a day. Then he went to middle school. And then he went to high school, graduated high school, skipped a couple of grades, and was part of the National Honor Society. Then he graduates high school. All the other kids are going to college. Most parents, especially Jewish parents, you know, if your kid doesn't go to college, it's a disappointment and a failure. And Syracuse University said, we'll take him. And he goes to Syracuse on the 10-year plan. Takes a course here, takes a course there, is admitted numerous times to the hospital for all kinds of challenges. And he graduates college in 2009, same year that his younger brother graduates rabbinical school, days apart. And he graduates Syracuse University, summa cum laude, which I got to tell you, I didn't graduate summa. My wife didn't. None of our kids did. And obviously, it was a special moment in our life. And I remember his graduation, people standing up and applauding. And I thought really they were applauding for Eyal, which in part they were. But I think part of the applause was also a reflection of themselves, of saying, look what this kid was able to do with all his limitations and his challenges. Yet it became really raised the bar for everybody else.
Look, okay. I want to know, what you have just done for everybody to see is show who Eyal's father is. That's about who you are, Chuck. Charles Sherman is just what you've described. The reality is, I want you to understand, they were applauding for Eyal. Because he is a magnificent example, human being, of what we all want to be ourselves. But at that moment, it was all about him. And for you to somehow shape it the way you just did is so sweet. I know why Eyal made it. He made it because he had a mother and a father who were not going to let him fail, who were not going to ever let him feel alone, and who saw, this whole philosophy of, in this house, there's going to be no crying. It's all about how we're going to celebrate wherever we are. And the reality is, No one's ever promised anything in this world.
Right.
God never makes a promise to us. And then the question is, whatever we've been given, do we make of it something? You helped your son. Your wife helped your son. For all I know, the kids, the other kids that you had who were part of this family, you all did this. It's an extraordinary story. It's about Eyal, but it's also about your entire family. And Kol HaKavod isn't even, doesn't touch it. By the way, there's a chapter here. We're not going to have time to do it. A marriage. And you write a chapter about you and Leah. It's just to die. It's the most loving chapter. You got to get this book. It is a different kind of journey that you normally read. This isn't a how-to book. This is a self-help book. It's not a book. It's not a book about the writer. It's a book about life in the biggest sense of the word. There is one element I do want to get to before I have to let you go. And I'm telling you ahead of time, we may not agree here. It doesn't matter. I want to hear what you have to say, and if I have something to say back to you, I will.
That's fine.
You do a chapter on faith. Okay.
Okay. I know where you're headed.
Yeah. Okay. And there was a lot you wrote about here, which I thought was so honest. And I don't know how much the audience will understand. Rabbis have a hard time being honest. That's just the truth. It doesn't mean they're bad people. Rabbis have an enormously hard time being honest about what they believe in sharing it with their congregations. And rabbis sometimes think they have to take certain stands and symbolize something. It's all nonsense. But they mean well. But rabbis have a hard time being as open about their own ambivalence, their own searching. And then you write this extraordinarily honest, courageous chapter. Did God do this to your child? The answer is no.
Right.
God did not do this to your child. And you know that. And this book is all about how do people respond in real life to things that happen. It's not God's fault. And if in some way you and your wife and your other children have been able to transcend, that is godliness in some extraordinary way. And when people read your chapter on faith, and you know the confrontation you have with Judy, whose son is Andy, you're in the hospital with another woman who finds out you're a rabbi, and she wants to ask you, why did God do this to me? And there are people who, when they have tragedy, that's their first question. By the way, the tragedy has to reach a certain level. At a certain level, then all of a sudden it's God's fault. I don't mean to put words in your mouth and I jump down your throat, but the reality is when I read your book, it didn't sound to me like you ever thought it was God's fault.
And you're correct. And what, you know, what I enlarge the conversation to is that, is being able to live with I don't know answers about life and about faith.
Isn't that the truth?
And that's what faith is all about.
Right.
Faith is not about certainty. Faith is about living in what I call the neighborhood of mystery. You know, I don't understand.
Okay, I want you to say it again. Faith is not certainty in the Jewish tradition.
All right, it's what I call living in the neighborhood of mystery, and it's uncomfortable, and it's hard, and that's all right. That's all right. I tell people that if you look in terms of our own history, we want to know everything, but there are limitations to the human personality.
Only at the moment, by the way, it's the only line in your whole book that I took issue with.
Which was what?
People want to know everything, and then you made reference to the Tower of Babel.
Right.
And I thought, in this minor thing, minor, and you do not have to agree with me, but I'm going to tell you my reaction. The Tower of Babel was not wanting to know everything. The Tower of Babel was about people thinking they could be God. The Jewish tradition says that there's nothing greater than learning, and that we will learn everything we can about God's universe. And that every time you study the chemistry table, the table of elements, you're doing Torah. And when you study natural science, it's Torah. When you study the human sciences, it's Torah. When you study the mathematics of this world that are the fundamental essence of natural law, you're studying Torah. When you study Talmud, you're studying Torah. But Torah is bigger than rabbinic texts. Torah is about this world. And the Jewish tradition wants us to learn as much as we can. And the only thing that limits us is our ability to yet know. What you and I know about the world, our great-great-grandparents wouldn't have a clue.
Correct.
Okay. And I don't know what my great-great-grandchildren will know about this world. It's not knowledge that is wrong. We don't know, however, a different kind of answer. And it's the ultimate human challenge. Why is there suffering in this world? And for me, the answer is it's part of what existence is. And what you've done is you've shown everyone who knows you, everyone who gets to read your book, everyone knows your darling son in there, everybody knows your wife and your other children, you live the answer. And the answer is it's all about how hard you hug and love and have a positive, and to the extent to which, and you'll know this reference, to the extent to which every one of us is asked to be a machshon, who does not sit idly by but plunges forward. You are the quintessential machshon. And that's the message that I want you to understand. One of the reasons why I want to meet you so much is I want to thank you. And I want to make sure people tell you what you've done. You've done it for your son. You've done it for your children. You've done it for your wife. You are an extraordinary rabbi as well. But then you wrote this book. Was this the first version of the book?
No.
How many versions?
Three.
Why? Fascinating story. Why?
The first one was called There Are No Atheists in Intensive Care. Great title. I wrote it about 30 years ago while this whole thing was beginning to happen. And I was taking notes on tissue paper, like from the doctors, and then like rabbis, I would look around at people and I'd say, as rabbis, we have this thing that goes off in our head and it says, that would be a great Yom Kippur sermon. That's a great Shavua sermon. That's a great sermon for that particular Sedra. And I would put it into a drawer and then I wrote it. And
it wasn't right, was it?
It didn't have, it was a mean-spirited,
yes,
angry,
yes,
misery memoir.
Yes.
And then I wrote it a second time.
But you knew it at some point.
Oh, yeah.
Or did somebody have to tell you?
No, I knew it.
You knew it wasn't the right book.
Didn't feel right.
Then you write a second book.
About 15 years later.
15 years later.
Which is nastier and meaner than the first one. And then...
Because?
I think it was a way for me just to ventilate a lot of my feelings.
Yes, you had it right.
This is what it was. And then finally about...
But it wasn't right.
Oh, no. It was...
And you knew it wasn't right.
It was,
did your wife tell you it wasn't right?
Not really. Not
but
really.
You knew
oh,
it.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And then I got back to it about 4 or 5 years ago. And I was in
a different book.
And the reason was different, I was a different person. I was in a different stage of my life. There were a different kind of maturity, different kind of life experience. And I was able to look back on it. You see, when I was writing it in the midst of all the turmoil, I was like in the eye of the hurricane. And now, not that I was objective, but I was able to look back at it and say, okay, what did I learn about that experience? Time and distance, space, allowed me to bring a different perspective really to it. And then I realized, I told the story up front for about 10, 12 pages, and then what I was able to do was take those major themes, like faith, like marriage, like joy, and anger, and optimism, and time, and bring in my personal narrative stories, but enlarge it because I realize it wasn't my story. I tell people when I go out to speak, and I say to them, if I went around the room this evening, I'd ask every one of you, please tell me your narrative. Each one of you will share with me compelling compelling stories. It may be about illness. It may be about issues within your family. It may be about in terms of a business. It may be about disappointments that you've had in your life. But all of us have a compelling narrative. And I recognize that, and this is why the book took a different kind of life. It was no longer a personal diary or a memoir. It was a life message. And something you said before is that, you see, when I graduated rabbinical school, we both graduated the same year, different rabbinical schools, the rabbin was that you did not share personal narratives. Your preaching was really text-related. Your preaching may have been about other people. What I have discovered is that the best messages that I deliver is when I share my soul and my kishkes, if you may, with my community. They're not my therapists, far from it. You got to be very, very careful. But it shows really, if there's an honesty and genuineness, a humanness of who I am. You know, a rabbi is, you know, I come with my challenges. I'm not perfect. I have a brokenness really about me. And in terms of the book, it's based upon that famous midrash. In terms of when Moses goes up to the mountains, gets the Ten Commandments, comes down, see people worshiping the golden calf, breaks the tablets, goes up a second time, gets the second tablets. And the question, of course, asked in the text is, what happened to the broken pieces? And what people used to say to people, I'd say, move along with life, put the pieces back together again. When Eyal got sick over the years, people said the same thing to me. Put the pieces back together again. Move along with your life. And like in the text, they took the broken pieces and they put it in the Ark of the Covenant, the broken ones and the whole ones together, and they journeyed onto the Promised Land.
But they didn't try to put the broken pieces together.
Exactly. They remain broken.
Incidentally, you do two things in the forward of your book, I'll just tell people. The first, there's an Eshes Chayil reference where you obviously are paying tribute to Leah. It's gorgeous. It's followed by Humpty Dumpty. You can't put the pieces together,
that's
right?
That's exactly it.
And boy, you have those two passages at the very beginning of the book. That's, it says it all. It's whoever thought of that, if it was you, it was brilliant. Humpty Dumpty. And the question is, what do you do with life when you can't put the pieces together?
Right.
And you show us what you did. By the way, are you a sweeter person now than you were 40 years ago?
I'm a different person.
Are you a sweeter person?
I think more gentle and more generous, absolutely. You know, it was interesting, you know, a woman once came up to me when I offered, after into this for a few years. She was a woman who had lost a child herself, a 14-year-old kid. And she, in congregational life, not everybody is your closest friend. She was not one of my biggest fans. And she said to me, she wrote me this letter and said, ever since Eyal got sick, you're a better rabbi. And I became very angry, very angry. And I misunderstood her. And I was angry, obviously, on one level, because I'd rather be the worst rabbi in the world than the worst person, but to know my son was going to be well again. But she herself was further along the journey than I was. And I understood really what she was saying. What she was saying to me is what you were experiencing is a life-transforming experience. And if I sat here with you today and said I am the same person as I was before Eyal took sick in March 1986.
No, it's not about Eyal. It's about the first version of the book.
Well, that's true.
The first version of the book was angry. The second was angrier. You said that. It struck me. This is not an angry book. This is one of the sweetest books I've ever seen. And I said to myself, as you said it, is there an arc for Chuck? Are you, because I have to tell you, I only know you now.
Right.
You're the sweetest guy in the world. And so I'm saying to myself, isn't this what you always were? Maybe you weren't always. Maybe you were sort of a pompous, arrogant, typical conservative rabbi.
You probably knew me back then. That's exactly it, huh? With all the respects to my profession. How did you know me then? That's exactly it. I was driven. I was arrogant. I thought really I had all the answers to life. Okay, as you know, is that you get 3,000 people on the holidays. I can get them to stand up like that one time, get them to sit. I can move them this way, I can move them that way. Absolutely. You know what, Mark? Those days are over. And you know what?
Good for you.
I'm glad that they're over. I'd rather have learned it differently.
Of course.
But what you said, I'm about a more gentle person, but I certainly believe I'm a better person.
You're a lovely, lovely man. I want you to just finish the thought, and we have to wrap up. Did this experience change the way you, and I'm not sure what the right verb is. You'll give me the right verb. But I'm talking about whatever your personal appreciation for God is, understanding of God is, relationship with God is, faith. I don't want to use the word faith. It's by the way, it's people, if you know Hebrew, you understand there's now the word faith is really a slight mistranslation in terms of the way it's used in other religious traditions. But I'm asking you, do you experience, do you describe, do you encounter whatever you mean by the word, by the divine, differently now than you did before? And because there are people who always say somebody who has, to somebody who's experienced what you have, well, did you lose faith in God? And, you know, did God answer your prayers? And we've already had this moment about rabbi to rabbi. I'm not asking you as a rabbi. I'm asking you as Chuck Sherman, is there a journey you've been on? Can you tell me where you are now? And by the way, I won't ask him at the moment, but I almost want to say, you just go over this. I'm going to bring Erez in here. I want to hear what Erez says about his father in this question, but what's your answer?
My answer is that people will ask me frequently, when did you regain your faith? And I tell them, I never lost it. And they ask me why, and I do not know why. That is part, really, of always been my belief system. You know, I've never related to God really as being this person who was going to just make everything all right really for me. But I do know my faith has kept me on the, given me really the emotional strength to meet these horrible challenges. And our faith and belief has kept our family really together.
Faith in what?
You know, faith in God, faith really.
Faith in God?
Absolutely. I don't understand. I use really in the book, to me that I find Maimonides' principle, anima mi be'munah shleima. You know, I believe in complete faith, bevir HaMashiach, correct the idea of messianism. Yeah, afal pish hu hitmameya, and that to me is, my belief system is afal pish, even though, and that's where I am. That's where I am in life. I'm in that even though moment, but I still believe. And if you ask me again why, I cannot give you a rational answer.
Does it matter?
Absolutely not.
Absolutely.
And that again is what belief is all about in terms of my system and faith. Yeah, I don't have to rationalize it to anybody. It's a feeling that I have, and we've been able to transmit that same kind of feeling to our kids. Jewish ritual, Jewish ceremonies, which is part of the faith experience, has kept this family together. If you came to our house on a Friday evening when everybody is together, you know, it's a remarkable, remarkable experience. It's a
joyous Shabbat table.
It's incredible. It's miraculous. Number one is that it seems ordinary. It seems ordinary. Number two is that Eyal is wheeled over to the table, and he leads Kiddush for us, silent Kiddush. The only time we allow him to have any food in his mouth, because otherwise what happens, he aspirates. He gets a couple of drops of wine from a Kiddush cup that we had given to him when he was born, so he still uses it. And then he gets a teaspoon of chicken soup. It's the only time, then we quickly suction it out because we see it's just going to really go into his lungs. And then when we do Birkat HaMazon, each kid has a part, and Eyal's part is Uvene Yerushalayim Irakodesh. And what he'll do is, and that's his part. And in the book, in fact, that's the way the book ends, is that I talk about of rebuilding Jerusalem. And it's interesting because he's had that part ever since he's a kid. And what it means really is not simply Jerusalem, the city, but Jerusalem becomes really the promised part, mm-hmm. really, of the dream and the journey mm-hmm. that we all have. Now, do I have a dream for him? Of course I do. My dream is I wake up tomorrow morning, I walk into his room, he's sitting up in bed without all this equipment, he says, good morning, Abba. Okay, of course I have that. I'm not ready to lose that dream. Okay, I still have that dream. And you know what, Mark? I'm going to have that dream to my dying day. Because what I've learned in life is that you never, never know. And part of growing up, you talked about being arrogant, is that I used to, you know, if I had to use a punctuation mark about it the way I used to be, I was an exclamation point. I was the exclamation point. Now, if you ask me, I'm the question mark. And maybe the ellipsis. That's where I am in my life at this point.
That's a beautiful metaphor. You should just tell one more story. There's always one more story in this book. Tell me one more story. Eyal becomes a bar mitzvah. By the way, I shouldn't say that. He has a bar mitzvah ceremony. Eyal, who cannot speak a word, but knows everything, has a bar mitzvah ceremony. How does that describe that moment?
I remember his bar mitzvah. He gave a Devar Torah.
So describe it. On the pulpit is your son. There are television cameras internal to the building.
Correct.
Who are putting everything up on this large screen.
And several huge production trucks on the front lawn of the synagogue.
Okay. And there are close-ups of his face so that when he mouths something, there's a chance that you will really understand it. And you also have subtitles as well.
Correct. Correct.
Okay. And he does the entire, his portion of the service that way.
Correct.
Okay. And by the way, I'm sure not one person wasn't thrilled to be there and gave you no halachic grief. Tell me I'm right. Don't tell me there was somebody in your congregation who raised a halachic question here.
I don't think it was a halachic question. I dealt more in terms really of personalities. You know, in terms of, well, why couldn't my kid have that? And listen, you deal with that silliness. Welcome to the world of the rabbinates. You got to put things in perspective. It's a larger world out there. It really is. But I think, you know, I remember after he gave his Devar Torah. Now,
and how did he do that? Again, subtitles?
Exactly. But the interesting thing, how did he write it?
Yes.
Because he doesn't use adaptive equipment. What he does use is that we have a little switch here on his chin. And he can maybe move like this. For example, Stephen Hawking has really a computer that will speak really for him. It takes a long time to program it, but it's an artificial voice. That's not Stephen Hawking's voice. We did not want to go with an artificial voice. We felt it's not natural, even though it's hard to read Eyal's lips, but it's much more spontaneous. So for him to prepare for it, for his Devar Torah to write it, he had a little switch here. And he bumps his head like this, and the computer will come to a letter. It takes him hours and hours and hours to do it. And the interesting thing is that, you know, when he got done, the congregation stood and sustained applause. And I spoke about innocence. And I remember him, his eyes raised. My wife was standing next to him as I was. I was ready to give him the bar mitzvah charge. And he turned to my wife and he said, did he do something wrong? Because he understands synagogue etiquette. And we turned to him and said, you did everything right. You did everything right.
Okay, so sum it up for me. Is there something you wish people would take away from when they read your book? I don't mean this in any way except positive. You had to write this book for you. You tried three times, then you got it really right.
Right.
But you wrote this book for you. You had to write this book. Then you've written this book, The Broken and the Whole, Discovering Joy After Heartbreak. when you give it as a gift to somebody who reads it, is there something you hope that the reader will take away from it?
I mean, absolutely. What I hope they take away from it is that irrespective of the challenge you are facing, it's not that someone's going to get a magic wand and make it all better, but it's possible to live with the broken pieces of your life, to discover joy, as the title says, to affirm life, validate life, and life yet can still be good and meaningful every single day of your life. It's interesting, when I finished the book, I turned to the publisher, it's Scribner, my editor, and I said, it's the wrong title. She says, what do you mean it's the wrong title? I said, it's titled Discovering Joy After Heartbreak. I said, it should read Discovering Joy with Heartbreak. It was too late to do it. If I could change it, I certainly would have changed. And that really is what the message of our life narrative is about, and hopefully people will take it from it. You can discover joy with heartbreak. It's different, but life still can be terrific.
It is the most wonderful message I could imagine. That's the gift, by the way. It comes back to some, you know, your whole bit about Ecclesiastes as well. But it is a transcendingly positive Jewish message.
Thank you.
You're a remarkable human being. I mean, what you've done is spectacular. Your father, your husband, you're a great rabbi, and now you're a great guest on Lachaim. You have to be back. I will not let your hand go unless you promise to come back.
Give us an invitation, we'll be back.
Thank you. Kol tuv v'hatzlacha.
Thank you, Mark.
A spectacular job.
Thanks. I appreciate it.
Thank you. Charles Sherman, Chuck Sherman. Again, a remarkable human being, author of The Broken and the Whole, Discovering Joy with Heartbreak, published by Scribner. And Charles is also the rabbi of Temple Adat Yeshurun in Syracuse, New York. And he is an extraordinary rabbi, and you've learned here some of the reasons why. It's been a real honor to present him to you. As always, I hope you'll share any of your own thoughts or feelings with me. Has Charles Sherman said anything that has especially touched you, or perhaps has been of some help to you in your own life's journey? Please email me, write me, post on our Facebook wall, or tweet me at Rabbi Mark S. Golub. I'm becoming a more active tweeter. So if you tweet me, if you follow me, it'll make me very, very happy. And I want you to stay in touch with me. And thanks this time to our producer for this edition of L'Chaim, Kara Lilienthal, to Sloan Copeland, our director, Serge Goldberg, our program coordinator, Igor Funk and Alex Barash behind the cameras. Thanks also to Rabbi Mitch Hurwitz up in Greenwich, Connecticut, for making sure that Chuck Sherman sat at this table. Until the next time, I'm Mark Golub. L'chaim, my friends, to life.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support Shalom TV with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double high or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the Shalom TV website homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to JEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive on DVD with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.
L'chaim is a presentation of Jewish Education in Media.